Absolutely.
What is it good for?
Say it again.
Justin Hires.
Hey, hey.
Okay, who Woo! Sings this? Who sings this?
Radio Silence. I don't know who
it is. Nobody?
I don't know either.
What's that?
Edwin Starr.
Oh, I would have said Cory and Topanga. That's how I found it on Boy Meets World.
Nice.
Yeah.
I would have said War, the band.
Yeah.
I had a crush on Topanga growing up.
Yeah, she was mad, huh?
Who didn't?
Yeah, no.
Justin, look at you.
What's up, man?
I'm telling you this from the bottom of my heart. Like, good things are coming, my friend. I know they're already here.
Thanks, man.
But they're going to keep coming. This is amazing. CBS Rush Hour, the infamous, famous movie. I shouldn't say infamous.
Yeah.
Right? And,
yeah.
And the reboot, and we've had Amy Garcia in here, who we love.
Oh,
who
I love Amy. She's the heart of the show, Amy Garcia. She and Wendy Malick is like the backbone. It's like everyone plays like a special part to making that show great. Yeah.
Are you hearing good things from the bosses?
I am. Well, actually, yes. I think the ratings are going up now. I think the people are starting to gravitate towards it more and more every episode. Because the first episode was somewhat of a reboot of the original. So some people liked it, some people didn't.
Yeah, you got to get started.
Got to get started.
You have to get started.
I thought
started.
It was a nice reminder, though, of what was going on. Aww. Like, refresher. I liked it. But
you know,
I think it's getting better, more fun.
Yeah, me too.
I think we
too.
Actually have to educate audiences. Give them a 3-episode rule.
Six, Kev. I think six.
Nowadays, I think. And I've seen a study done on, like, Netflix. Most people start to really clock in and, like, continue to watch a series. I think around episode 4 or 5.
Four or five. Yeah, okay, yeah. So let's say, because I know with Maria Menounos, who you know, my fiance.
Yeah, she's great.
I know you know. And I lost her on Boardwalk because she checked out after the first episode. I lost her on Vinyl. She checked out after the first episode. And I'm convinced you have to, you've got to, if because I felt the same way she did, but you really have to give it the 3 or 4.
You do.
And you guys are 4 in now, right?
We're 5 in, I think.
5 in.
I think. I'm losing
count. Yeah, you had your 5th one, although I'm still concerned about you and your cousin and what's going on.
What's your concern?
I'm just
Paige
worried.
Kennedy.
Yeah. I'm worried about it.
That's funny.
He's going to screw you over.
Yeah, he might. You
just
never
throwing
know.
It out there.
You
let's,
never know.
Let's start earlier with your career. 21 Jump Street.
Yeah.
You right? You did the film?
I did. And ironically, Jonah Hill hired me because he saw my audition tape and he said, I think this kid might be like have something that Chris Tucker has. Like to
that's what he said. Wait, he said that to you, or
he said that to me 5 years ago when he cast me.
So wait, so was Jonah Hill was because he was producing?
He was a producer. Yeah, 21 Jump Street was essentially his film. Like he brought on Channing Tatum and did all of that.
I think it's literally those two are the some of the funniest films I've seen in the last decade.
Yeah,
right.
So good. Kyle,
yeah,
I agree.
They were great. I was pleasantly surprised. I like, oh, this ain't no bullshit. So I mean, I'm glad. I think Channing Tatum like surprised everybody.
Yeah, he's amazing.
How funny he was in that movie. And 100%. Luckily, I had like a memorable scene, you know, so it worked out. Well for me.
Okay, so watching those two, and I don't know if he can speak to this or not. They look like they were having a lot of fun together doing it. Were they?
They were. No, absolutely. And you know what? Watching those two guys, it helped me become a better actor because I realized that they weren't acting. Like, they were just talking. You know, sometimes as an actor, you feel like, oh, I got to talk like this to save my lines. And they were just, like, talking. And so, like, literally watching their interaction between each other on and off screen, like, literally made me a better actor.
It's funny. Yeah. You know, Uncle Junior from The Sopranos. Mm-hmm. I was listening to a interview with him last night from a shout out to Gilbert Gottfried's podcast, by the way. If you're a fan of old television, old film, it's a wonderful podcast. But they're interviewing Uncle Junior, and I think it was either John Frankenheimer or it was Sidney Lumet who was working with an actor, and he kept saying, give me less, a little less, give me less, less, less. One take after another. Okay, now can you just give me a little less? Just a little less, a little less. And finally, you know, Uncle Junior reacts, you know, and says to him, if I give you any less, I won't be acting. And he said, exactly.
Exactly. That's so true. That's exactly right. Yeah.
So I like the fact that because when I don't know why, because I'm such a fan. I like when I know you guys are having fun too. I was a little disappointed when I met, he's a great actor, at AfterBuzz, I met from Californication, not David Duchovny, but his best friend. Christian, who's his best friend?
Oh, mm-hmm.
I know who you're talking about.
Right, he's a fantastic actor.
Yeah.
He can reinvent himself in 100 different ways.
You want to know what? He is like one of the, I think, meanest people that I have encountered.
Come on.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah, talk about it.
Wait, he was...
Yeah.
He was good to me, but then again, I own AfterBuzz. Maybe that's why.
No, Evan Handler.
Evan Handler,
He was on Sex and the City also.
Yes, yeah. He also played Larry in the Three Stooges.
Alan Dershowitz.
Yeah.
He was Alan Dershowitz in the OJ.
He's great. I mean, he's a great actor.
Great actor. Yeah, so I'll tell you,
maybe he was having a bad day, but he was very, very not nice to me.
Tell me what happened.
A couple of times. One time.
Oh, a couple times. Oh, it's getting
juicy.
Yeah,
but you want to know what? It's actually bad that I'm telling the story again, but I'm going to do it because I have no fucking filter, but... I was covering the Californication after show for AfterBuzz TV, and on air after I met him, I was like, this guy is a dick. And then the publicist, like the people we were booking, they pulled all of the guests and they were like,
rocks.
We're not sending you. Like, rocks. Why would we send you our people?
Rocks
and I was like,
a million.
Oh, that makes sense.
Oh, no.
But now I'll retell the story.
I mean, it's tomorrow's show. We're not totally affiliated with AfterBuzz.
Yeah, that was a lesson that I learned. Apparently not well enough, though.
But what happened?
We were at the AfterBuzz gifting suites. It's the first time that I met him. And we were trying to get him. He was just, you know, busy getting his gifts, but we were trying to get him on the show. And he just kept, like, anytime he'd interact with me, one of those people who was like, I think he wanted to spit on me. He was just, everything he said, looked down at me and be like, oh, no, I don't do things like that. I don't do things like that. Mm-hmm. I would never come on. And it was just so disrespectful. And I was like, listen, that's totally fine. Like, have a good day. And he just kept going in on why it was so disrespectful of us to ask him for an interview. He was just there for the gifts. And all he wanted was the free gifts and whatever. And I was like, wow, you're not the kind of guy that we want on the show anyway.
Wow.
And
got to turn that over to your handlers, Evan. So now lesson, Justin. Right?
Lesson learned.
You got to be like, yeah, just everybody's friend, just whatever, and then your people go in and they're the bad guys
for you. They're the bad guys for you.
Yeah, I would love to do it.
Right.
Yeah.
But these guys, yeah.
They won't let me.
It could have been a bad day, but I saw him one other time, and I saw him being
still
mean
was
to
like
another
girl. He was an a-hole again.
Yeah, totally.
Well, he was nice to me, but what I was sad about, I said, your chemistry with David Duchovny is crazy.
So good.
You guys look like you're having so much fun. He said, it's just acting. I was like, and I was so sad, like, you know, because I'm such a fan. So when you see, I love when I watch the guys from 21 Jump Street, I'm like, they look like they're having so much effing fun.
Yeah,
right?
They were.
So were you having the same amount of fun on Rush Hour?
I am. You know, I tell people, some of my favorite scenes, it's funny you mentioned Paige, is because some of our scenes together are some of my favorite, actually.
No, they're hysterical, but you're going to get burned, but they're hysterical.
So my scenes with him, Wendy Malik, what I love about my chemistry with John is that, you know, he's a natural introvert and I'm a natural extrovert. And so we have that perfect chemistry, like that yin and yang.
Yeah.
And so it's the same thing that made the films work, I feel like, is making the show work. Because it's that perfect, like, odd couple pairing. You know? And it leans itself to great, I think, humor and a great story.
Do you want to trash anyone? Right now that we're in the mood.
Okay, just see Ian with Ian with the eye patch. The kid's just starting his career. Just look at him.
Right.
But just... puts on an eye patch and just turns into the bad guy.
I love everybody. Yeah, is that real?
That, a real eye? Yeah.
A real eye patch.
No. He has a sty on his eye.
Oh, you have a sty on your
eye. He's super vain.
Okay, gotcha.
And Roxy's super paranoid about germs. And now they somehow blamed it on me. Like, I said to that he had to do it. But
no, styes aren't contagious, though.
No, I think they are.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
I think they are. But I just want to see it to know
how
fucking bad it is.
But then this is the millennials, how they think. But then go to Roxy's car.
It's
and
dirty.
It's the biggest pig sty you've ever seen.
Filth everywhere.
No, it's not dirty. It's disorganized.
Mm.
I'm very disorganized. I'm very clean,
it's
but disorganized.
Honey.
Can I ask you a real question?
Yeah.
What was the first, when you talk about acting and acting, was it acting was your first love or was it comedy or like what was the call to arms that made you have to go into the industry?
That's a great question. I grew up watching martial arts films, like Jean-Claude Van Damme and Bruce Lee movies.
Cool.
And so I started doing martial arts. I'm a black belt in karate.
Wow.
But then, I know it's so random that I'm doing Rush Hour now. So I started, I got my black belt. And when I got my black belt, I realized that it was actually the films that I was in love with. And I saw Chris Tucker in the movie Friday. I used to watch Martin, his TV show, Martin. Grew up on Eddie Murphy films. And so I realized I wanted to be an actor and a comedian because I was always the class clown. And so it's kind of like went hand in hand. You know?
Grew up in L.A.?
I grew up in Florida. I'm from St. Petersburg, Florida.
Okay.
And I've been out here for 9 years now. When I moved out here, that's when I really started doing stand-up comedy and, you know, honing my craft.
Okay, note millennials, 9 years that he has invested into the business.
That's right. Because
the millennials think it's 9 weeks, they nine days.
I always tell people, I heard Will Ferrell say it take 10 years to become an overnight success.
Yeah.
And I did my first film 11 years ago. And I've been in L.A. almost 9 years. So, yeah, it's definitely a marathon, not a sprint.
Yep.
Yeah, absolutely.
Don't I say that all the time, Roxy?
Mm-hmm. All the time. I'm coming up on 7, so, you okay. know, I got
no,
a few
these
more.
No, these guys aren't that. They're not. My crew is bad because I wouldn't tolerate it. But what we see out there is that, you know, they want to make it. And you must get approached by so many people saying, how? Right? How did you do it? How do I get in?
Absolutely. And I tell them the main thing is, you know, having faith in yourself, not telling yourself no. I tell people all the time, it's enough people in Hollywood or in life period that's going to tell you no to things, your dreams, your goals. So like, don't be one of the people telling yourself no. You know, it's like, let them tell you no, but don't tell yourself no. And just, you know, just put in the work.
Okay, so here's the thing. I find a lot of artists like yourself. So Ross Matthews was here, a few weeks ago.
He's hilarious.
He's great. And I was asked, but, you know, I think because you guys are so deep in the forest, you don't see the trees. Because because that's all the fortune cookie stuff.
Right, right.
Okay, but see, what I hear, black belt.
Right.
Someone who had focus.
Yeah.
Who was willing to put in a lot of work at something that was not going to pay them money.
Absolutely.
Or get them fame.
Absolutely.
Okay, who had a passion for films and other things, has a positive attitude. So I see the things that really what it takes, because there's enough people, they want to hear that. Yeah, just keep telling yourself,
right,
you can do it.
Right.
But then you're sleeping till 1 o'clock every day, and you're out of the bars every night. But you're telling yourself you can do it.
And I make sure to tell all my friends, comedians, and actors that's coming up. You know, I always tell them, you have to, your work ethic have to match your dream ethic.
There you go. Now that's what I want.
If you're dreaming big, you need to work like as hard, if not harder, to accomplish those dreams that you have.
Yeah, I agree with you completely, though, Kev. Because when you were talking, you said I'm a black belt, totally random. Random now with Rush Hour. I don't think that's random at all.
Right. No,
you know,
not at all.
I think right. that's because you put in all of that work, and now that's translated to a role that you
But it's
have.
That work ethic
right.
that helps you proceed in.
Absolutely. I mean, that's all. I pride myself on my work ethic. I try to instill that in my friends and my relatives, you know, to just, it's necessary. You know, it really is necessary. So, because no one's going to give you anything, you know. And so it's like, if you really want it, you gotta go out there and take it.
So, you know, and then, by the way, because I can already tell, and I'd like to think I'm a pretty fast judge. I know you're not one who cuts corners, and you won't slice someone's throat. You're a good kid. I can see it. That also makes it even harder.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's so crazy. It's funny you bring that up, because my friend was just telling me how, it's unfortunate how it seems like the biggest people can sometimes be the a-holes, and it seems like the good guys, it's harder to achieve that level of success. So that puts me yep. in a very tough dilemma, like almost like mentally, where it's like, do you need to be that way to get there, or is it going to take me longer to get there, or what?
Okay, we reference Star Trek a lot on this show. There was a great line in the
right. I can't tell.
You can't tell. There was a great line, and I want you to remember this: that Dr. McCoy said to Captain Kirk. He said, "In my experience, evil usually triumphs unless good is very careful." So my translation of that has always been, we have to work harder, and we have to make those smarter choices.
Right.
It's really hard. Now, again, you know, my fiance Maria is a good girl. She
yeah.
just is. I mean, she just, it's all about charity work and helping people, and never thinks, first of all, doesn't even want it bad enough for herself where she'll fight hard enough. She'll work her ass off, but she's not super ambitious, but would never think to cut someone's legs out.
Right.
And all we see, not all we see it in, I would say half. So I think half of the people that are super successful I call them, they're killers. They're fucking killers.
Yeah, I know.
And you know them.
I'm
and I wish I could talk. By the way, listen, there's a lot of stuff going on in the press right now with people moving around their positions, whatever, in the last 6 months. So I don't want to name names. But know that it's based on the fact that they're killers. And the other parties aren't killers.
Right.
So, but we see it all the time. And they are willing. They're willing to go there.
Yeah.
They're willing to hurt, slight, whatever they have to do. But then I know the other people that aren't like that and still make it. And I will tell you that the people who aren't like that are happier human beings and happier later in life because they don't need it that bad. There's just people who cannot, this is their, this is their fuel. They cannot live without the fame. They cannot live without the spotlight. And that's why they'll kill you for it. But then in the end, the spotlight goes out for everybody.
Right.
Nobody get, you know, you, right, unless
absolutely.
You die at the peak of your fame,
right.
It dims. And these people go absolutely mad. Wow. Like at the end of their life, I was blessed. I had this friend who was friends with all the old movie stars. And he would bring me around them when I was young, when I was your age. And these people, stars that I grew up and idolized, were so bitter and angry. And everybody, all you guys, the new actors and stuff, sucked. Everybody sucked. Had no talent. Hollywood was way better than our movies were better. And it was because of that. They were just, and by the way, no terrible relationships with their children. Mm. Only having sycophants around them. If you go to Sunset Boulevard, by the way, that movie.
Right.
Billy Wilder did. I'm telling you, it is so accurate for then and now. Everything is in that movie.
Wow.
To tell you what's going on for when you're like that. So yeah, those people are going, they're half those people, and they are going to be more, they are going to get ahead faster. But you know what? I will tell you, the nice hosts that I know out there, you know, are just great people, great to be friends with, and I don't know, just tend to be a lot happier like later in life when it does fade.
Right.
So you just have to work harder and smarter. But yeah, oh, it's coming.
Yeah.
Oh, it's coming. You're going to be.
Yeah.
You're going to be horrified with. Some of the stuff you're going to see. I'm not saying it to scare you, just to mentally prepare you.
Prepare you, yeah. I'm thankful for the story because I know it's true. I know it's absolutely true. I see it here and there now, and I know it's only going to get, you know, worse the higher I start to climb. And yeah, so, you know.
You know what else I've heard, too, and I don't want to put you on the spot, so you don't have to comment on it, but I've heard, so I've invested in this network called Black Hollywood Live, and Dario Christian, who I wish was here tonight to talk about this, is a president of the network, and he was saying, Keven, to be a black and African American in Hollywood, it's hard for us to even to support one another. He's like, when it's a war and we have to throw down support, we will. He said, but in the day to day, it's hard for us to do that because there's only so many spots for us. He's like, so it's even harder for us. Yeah, right. I see it hard for a lot of the females too.
See, I have an opposite mentality. And see, because of that mentality is why it's so hard for African Americans to support one another because they feel, oh, there's only five spots or there's only one spot. Right. So I can't help the other African American because that's the only
terrible.
Spot. Other than thinking, yo, how about we work together?
Yes.
You know, or there's enough roles out there, especially now, for all of us.
Okay, so this is what can help you in your is business wise. You know, I can't walk into every TV pitch I do. They go, good. That sounds interesting. So, is there an urban element?
Right.
Do you think we can get an urban host?
Right.
I mean, so right now, the belief of the suits is, for at least for TV, it's minorities and African Americans that are the most loyal viewers.
Absolutely.
And so
most networks are built on minority audiences.
That's it right now. So now you're right, is the time. Movies, listen, the urban films are all making money.
Mm-hmm.
It's absolutely. The most bankable. Ian, you're, as a filmmaker, you know this. Like, they're the most profitable in terms of making a profit. Not that they're making hundreds of millions, but they are. You will make a profit. Chances are very good if you make an urban film, you're going to make a profit.
Without a doubt, Tim Story, Maria's friend, has done very well.
Yeah, Tim Story. I know a great producer, Will Packer. He put me in my first two movies, but he produces all of Kevin Hart's films, and all of his movies open number one.
But God, you see, even Kevin Hart, I remember meeting him, I think it was a Today Show or something. We were promoting something. He was promoting something. And I remember just, he was ripping Maria for working so hard. And she goes, "Who? Look who's talking. You're everywhere." And I said, "You know, Maria, that's the problem with you is that, you know, you think it's work." Okay, so he does it. And I told him, I said, "Kevin, I don't know you." I go, "But you keep going." And we fist bumped and we had a nice moment. He's like, "Hell yeah." Like, but I'm sure it's that same fear of like, I'm going to lose my spot.
Well, yeah, that's why I think some of those people do work as hard as they do. It's a fear of losing a spot. I think what I learned from Kevin Hart specifically is to definitely strike while the iron is hot.
Yeah.
Because he knows that isn't going to last forever. So you want to try to create whatever type of brand and whatever type of legacy or whatever.
Kind
of
keep shoveling coal onto the fire. You just have to.
Absolutely. And so that's where I'm at right now. Even with Rush Hour, you know.
What are you allowed to do at CBS? Because he's Uncle Les. Is, right? He's right. Tough with the news. He's a great boss.
That's
like,
true.
If he likes you, great guy.
Well, nothing. I'm doing CBS right now. You know, but in my personal time, because, you know, I don't know if it's going to get another season yet or not. You know, I hope it does. But if it doesn't, I want to already have things prepared to go, you know.
So you're creating your own content?
Absolutely. I'm creating my own content. I'm a huge believer in creating, having creative control. I want to be a producer. I want to write. You know, I want to direct. I want to have my own production company.
It's the future. I was talking to someone at AfterBuzz today about this, and it's still hard to get through to these kids. I'm like, listen, the bridge that a lot of these guys built, you know, it's going away. You know, the bridge that Ryan Seacrest or Maria built or whatever, like, they're there. They built that bridge to get where they needed to be, but that bridge now is gone. Because everything is collapsing around us. Everything's changing. But the good news is you can't self-produce. That's going to be the future. The fact that you can, in a crude way, pick up your Periscope and literally we could be doing your Periscope talk show.
Right.
Like that. The fact that that can happen now in a crude sense. Where is this all going? Of course it's going to be where you can produce your own stuff. So now where you're famous on CBS and this is the technology that exists now. It's so smart because this is where it's going.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I agree. Even before when I first moved out here and I wasn't on any TV shows or films, I was one of the first early young black comedians that was hopped on YouTube.
Yeah, but I'm nervous because you haven't been uploading anything to Justin Hires TV, so that's why I asked about the content.
That's funny.
Justin, frequency and consistency.
Inconsistency. I know, and it's funny you say that because
Lauren, do we have to make him watch Captain Lou to teach him? Maybe
later. At some point, definitely.
You were almost there.
No, I started recording content that I'm going to start putting on my YouTube. It's not sketches, but it's more so just behind the scenes type footage.
Okay.
So I'm on the road doing stand up, and I'm going to start putting that out there.
My new student and friend.
School me, learn me, teach me something.
We're on the air when? Now.
Now. 24, yeah. I get
it. Is there a chance in 2 weeks we could not? Is there a chance that in 2 weeks, Uncle Les pulls the plug? Is there a chance? Or are you signed for the season? Do you guys know? Do you have a...
That's all.
No, you're signed, but I'm saying is Rush Hour...
It's 13 episodes.
But are they committed to even airing them all? Is that 100%? Stone?
No, I don't... Is that ever 100% in stone?
No.
On network TV.
It isn't. So, yeah. So my point is, every day, every minute, that you're not exploiting that,
right?
You're fucking up. This is why me and Maria have such a rough relationship. Right. But that's the Kevin Hart sense of urgency.
Right.
You have to view it like, you know what?
However, I tell you this.
Go ahead, tell me.
I'm on Snapchat every day.
Good man.
I'm on Instagram,
good.
Twitter, Facebook every day posting.
Good.
So the only thing that's really lacking technically is my YouTube.
Yeah, but you've got the 23,000 subscribers on here, and your last video was 2 months ago, but before that was a year ago. And I'm
Justin,
telling you, as a fan, I want to be able to watch your
Justin,
shit.
Justin, right. do you need manpower?
That would help.
We have some.
Okay.
We're legit too.
Okay.
Please, at Black Hollywood Live or AfterBuzz, you know how many kids would love to work with you and support your brand?
That's very true.
Because that's how they, you know what I mean? They'll get ahead. But I'm, listen.
He needs underpower.
I know, listen, it's great you're doing those other things, but you are on the world's biggest network.
Mm. Yeah.
Not just the countries, the world. Yeah, you are. Okay, but it's not about kissing the muscles and being excited. It's about saying, "Oh my God, we've got this very valuable space, this infomercial time." That's all I see this as.
Yeah.
You know? And we gotta until we hit our stride with the show, and even when you hit your stride, you still want to be shoveling the coal in the fire. But I think, you know, if Maria, when she got her first deal at Entertainment Tonight, she was 22, wow. And she got a 13-week contract, and she became the youngest person ever to host that show. In the 13-week contract, she wasn't paid a lot of money, very little. But I took what little we had and said, we got to hire a publicist right now. And this was at a time, not today everyone has a publicist. Back then, only major A-list stars had a publicist. Wow. And certainly reporters and hosts never had publicists. So in fact, I was laughed out of four offices.
Wow. Like,
said, no, she reports on the stars. She's not the star. I said, okay, next. And I kept going. And we took what little we had, because I was like, listen, if all we have is 13 weeks, I'm blowing the shit up out of this. And we did. But I've always, thank God, but I'm old. I was older than you are now. And I had the luxury of having all the failings in my own career to help Maria. But I'm telling you, this is a very precious space you're in. May it go for 14 years.
Right.
May we have that run. But every minute you have it is making the most. And by the way, you already are. You're here promoting, you're on Maria's show. Like, you're doing all those things. But if some people don't have the ability to create. You know, there's actors who all they can do is act, and then it's like I feel bad for them. But if you have the ability,
yeah, absolutely,
then we got to do more.
I agree. And you know, it's so crazy. I just got back in town yesterday, and the first post I put up yesterday was, I could be working harder. Even, and I pride myself on how hard I work, but I could be working hard. And I'm this is why I know I agree with what you're saying, because I'm watching TV and I'm still looking down at my cell phone. So that lets me know how powerful content on a cell phone is. Like, I'm watching new episodes or something, and I'm still like, what's happening on Facebook? What's happening on, you know, checking my notifications?
Yep.
You know, and so that lets me know that I still have to maintain and grow my presence online. Even
and
more
everyone
so.
Wants your spot.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot.
Black, white, yellow, it doesn't matter. They all want that spot.
Yeah.
You know, but anyway, again, I love the idea of we can always do better, and you know, always not. And when you think of some of the greats too, they never felt they were working hard enough. Jordan never felt he was working hard enough.
Yeah,
you know, he never did. Larry Bird never did. There's a lot of guys who have that mentality, and there's some guys who succeed because they're just so friggin' good that they don't have to be like that.
Right.
But we've talked about on this show where. I'm almost leery now of the people who say they're working hard.
Right.
Because I'm thinking, like, you know what?
They probably aren't.
You probably aren't.
Right.
Tell us how you got, it was the Comedy Diversity Showcase, that's how you got
CBS?
Discovered. Yeah.
Yeah.
So let's help some of the other people out there that want to know more about your journey.
Sure. So basically, I had just got with a new manager, Sherry Marsh, and she told me, you know, CBS has this CBS Diversity Showcase. And so I went to the audition just to meet with cast. It wasn't even an audition, I don't think, at first. I just met with the casting for Fern Ornstein over at CBS, the head of casting over there at CBS. So I met with her for a general meeting, and she just liked my personality, and she was like, I want you to come back for the CBS Diversity Showcase. So I did one audition, and she cast me off of my one audition. Fortunately, I didn't have to do callbacks like some of the other people. So she cast me off of that. And it was funny. I didn't know what it was still. I didn't know if it was a TV show or a movie. And basically, for anyone that don't know what it is, it's essentially Saturday Night Live for industry. So it's not telecast. It's basically you do comedy sketches on a stage in front of industry, in front of casting directors and producers and stuff like that. So that's essentially what it is.
One night, or you do it?
You do it for about two or three nights, but you rehearse for maybe 4 months, 4 or 5 months. Like, they have writers that come on board that help write, and the actors, we help write and develop these sketches. And so we start out with a bunch of sketches, and then it ends up with maybe 10 to 12 sketches with the cast that they pick. And So yeah, so that was my first like entry into like the CBS family, like, and so that kind of helped me do like I did two very lower tier CBS pilots that wasn't like high on their profile that didn't get picked up, but you know they had that footage of me, and so then when Rush Hour came along, Fern referred me. They couldn't find who they were looking for. They were they had a big audition. I was attached to another pilot at another network. Didn't know. I know. And
how'd you get out of it?
Well, I'm gonna tell you how
By the way, that happens a lot in Hollywood, and it sucks.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I'm gonna tell you.
By the way, you got out of it. Most people don't.
Well, I did it, and I'm gonna tell you how I got out of it. There was another show that I was up for, and that network didn't let me out of that contract to test for that show, and it was a huge show, and that show went off to be a major hit, and so when Rush Hour came around. My manager kindly said, you know, you didn't let Justin out of his contract for the last show. That show went off to be a hit.
No, what was the show? Well, the one that became a hit. That's not disparaging the other network, but what was the show that became a
That's
hit?
That's true. It was Empire. Yeah, exactly.
And they didn't let you audition or they didn't
I tested, but you know, they wanted me out of my contract with that other
network. Yeah, he couldn't get out of his contract. And okay, so you basically said to them.
So now here's the next year, and I shot a pilot with that same network, and now we didn't know.
A different pilot, though.
It was a different pilot. Yeah. So basically, with the other network, I was on a show with them, but we didn't know if that show was getting picked up when the whole Empire situation happened. So then fast forward another year, the show didn't get renewed. Empire's on. I shoot another pilot with that same network, and we didn't know if that pilot was going to get picked up. So then I was then allowed to go audition for Rush Hour.
Did it get picked up, the other pilot?
No, it didn't. It didn't get picked up.
By the way, that was nice that
they did
it. It was fair that they did that. We see it as fair, but I have to say nice because most of them don't play nice.
That's what I heard.
Most of them do not play nice. It's just insane.
Yeah. Yeah, I heard.
So then how did you get out of that, though?
Well, basically my manager sent them a gentle email, a gentle reminder like, hey
guys, come on.
Last year,
you did that
for Empire, and it went off to be Empire, and Justin still feels a certain kind of way about it, and it would be nice if you could do right by him. He's been nothing but loyal and helpful to your network if you could let him out.
I want you to find out who made the call to let you out of that. I mean that.
I know who it was.
Okay, because you need to remember that person for the rest of your career. You may have to throw that person a bone. You never know. But
I'll tell you later.
Okay.
But that person actually is doing online stuff now.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you know, the thing is, even spreading the positive love for that person, it hopefully will inspire other executives, because most of them go, fuck you. I don't give a shit. You'll see, like, it's crazy. Just the egos. Because the whole business is two things. It's talent and ideas. That's what drives our business.
Absolutely.
So it's either the talent, like yourself, or the Seth MacFarlanes or Mark Burnett's who have the ideas. Or in some cases, it's you're both. Someone like you is talent and ideas. Great. All these other people that are greenlighting and they're not those things. Their job is to facilitate, enhance, make it happen. But I feel like there's a little bit of an anger and bitterness that can set in with some of them because they're not those things. They want to say, I'm talent and ideas too. I'm just as important as they are.
Right.
And you're not.
Right.
So this is their moment to go, no, I'm not letting you out of your deal. And anyway, it's sickening. I'm really grateful. But remember that, you know, remember that whoever did it, remember that, because most of the time they don't. And I wish I could tell you the big A-list stars I know who could not take giant roles in things that they were offered because of the same situation. Wow.
In my mind, that's so crazy, though, because I would think that's the smartest move. Now that guy, man or woman, is not on your shit list. Now you're a bigger star. And now as a bigger star, if he wants you for something, you're going to be like,
it's good business for everybody. You would think.
Right.
Yeah. Because the business is talent and ideas. When you ingratiate yourself to someone who is talent, then it's better for you because the business is talent and ideas. But a lot of them rocks, they don't see it that way.
It's that's sad.
It's crazy Hollywood. But I'll tell you something, right? If Rush Hour goes well, knock on acrylic, if Rush Hour goes well, I actually like it better for you than Empire.
Well,
because I think you're going to get lost in Empire.
My wife said the same thing. And you know what? It is a better fit for me because I'm a comedian. And it's an action comedy. And as a comedian, your whole goal growing up for most of us is to star in like an action comedy film. And here
it's,
I am.
And it's mainstream.
And it's mainstream.
CBS is a cash cow. Yeah. Just whatever. I'm not saying that that's the most important thing, but why not?
And I would have been number 5 on the call sheet on Empire. I'm number 1 on the call sheet on Rush Hour. You know,
I'm curious, during that time, though, when you see Empire blowing up, a sitcom doesn't get picked up, and you don't know there's a Rush Hour ahead.
Right.
You seem like pure positivity, but for other people who are going through that, like, what mentally are you getting down? Are you?
Yeah,
like,
no, you know, I'm human. You know, I definitely was feeling, especially when you're driving in Hollywood and you start and you see the show gets picked up and you see the trailer for the show and you're like, the show looks good. When I read the script, I thought it was going to be successful. And now I'm driving down Sunset and I'm seeing the Empire billboards and I'm like, that was the character that
See,
I
Justin,
almost had.
This is why you are a good kid and you're going to have a lot of success, because I would have been violent. No, and I will tell you, these guys know it, and only in the last year or two that I've actually taken my foot off the pedal a little bit. There was one of the things I'm proud of and that I'm actually not so proud of is I never allowed it.
What do you mean by that?
I steamrolled over all of them.
Oh, did you?
Oh, I was just like, no, what you're doing is fucking wrong.
Right.
No, you know what? It's like, you know, we did right. Whatever the case is, it was a right and wrong. But I was like, no, not happening. Next. So let's talk about how we're going to make it happen. What do I have to give you? Do I have to pay you? I'm happy to make amends.
Right, right.
You know, but you're not stopping me.
Right.
And it would be like that, but in Hollywood, you can't be like that because I go to Suge Knight. I think of somebody who won a lot of battles, but in the end, it just doesn't work.
Yeah.
You cannot use force. They don't play like that in this business. It's all hug, hug, kiss, kiss, phony, phony, phony.
Right.
Stab each other in the back. That's acceptable.
Right.
But when you come straight at them and say, hey, no, this is not fucking right. And I'm not backing down. I'm going to fucking keep coming. You're frigging wrong and you know you're wrong.
Yeah. Because somehow Hollywood has the machine has an incredible way of making the person who is the victim look like the bad guy.
Yep. Oh, yeah. See, Lauren just goes, yes. And yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
That is so
yes.
True.
And for a young guy to know this, you're light years ahead. Oh, fucking yeah. I just had one of our AfterBuzzers who works on who graduated a major show. And like there's rumors out there that, she was just difficult. That's what.
Exactly.
No, like, what are you talking about? Like, that was not the case. You know, it was actually quite the opposite.
Right.
But.
Right. And so I'm aware of all of that, you know, and, you know, just try to, like you said, what was the smart moves, basically?
Yeah.
It's wise choices. No, I haven't always made them. But as I'm getting older and evolving, you know, I'm hearing no's on things. I'm going, okay.
Yeah.
And I'm learning to go, okay.
My mentality is not to get physical. My mindset is, okay, I see it as motivation to keep going forward, keep going harder,
how you have
creating,
to be, right.
keep coming up with other ideas.
They'll only make you better and strong. In the end,
absolutely.
If you keep coming, the thing is some people quit
right.
and get discouraged at these moments. But if you keep coming, and I've told this to Maria, I said, Maria, all they're doing to you is making you smarter, making you harder working, making you dig down deeper to create more. So you're right.
Pressure
but again, it really does.
Feel like you've been villainized in situations? Because I think we would all agree that you're the good guy.
Thank you. Yes, I have. Absolutely.
To your fans? Or?
That would surprise me.
Behind the scenes. Yeah, absolutely.
Wow.
Yeah. And I'm nothing but
what do you
love
do when
and
that
respect,
happens?
Keep being successful.
GMP.
Yeah, that's what we say. Get more powerful.
Yeah, because, you know, my father taught me that. I heard Frank Sinatra read the same quote. The best revenge is success. You
Can
know?
I add an asterisk, too?
Yeah.
And I tell these guys all the time. They'll hear me yell it to some of my employees. I'll say, and I don't want to yell it now because it bums out the guys in the booth, but I'll say, step on that. And what I mean by that is if false perceptions go out there about you, I'm a believer that if enough people in this room say the sky is pink, you'll go, geez, it looks blue to me, but I guess maybe it's a little pink. So if there's enough people who say Justin Hires is difficult, or you're falsely accused of something or falsely represented, it will become law.
Right.
And so I say, step on that.
Right.
Which is like, wait, okay, who find out who said it or who's saying it. Go right to the source. You don't do it confrontationally. Don't be threatening. But say, wait, that's actually not what happened. Here's what happened. Or let me educate you. You haven't heard my side. But however you do it, you have to step on it because it becomes law. Unfortunately,
right. The
perception becomes reality. So,
true.
Sometimes, yeah, it's dig down deeper, become more successful. But it's tough to tolerate when it's unjust. When they're saying you're a diva, when they're saying you're difficult on set.
Luckily, I haven't had to that magnitude. But
what's it been like, just in general terms, where you've been vilified?
Well,
or the victim.
I feel like certain projects. You know, I wasn't put in certain projects because, you know, not doing something that someone wanted me to do. You see what I'm saying? And so maybe
couch? Is that
no? I'm just saying because maybe you're difficult or you're just
well because you know what I've learned in Hollywood is people hate hearing the word no. You know, like you know, especially people of power. It's okay for them to say no, but if they feel like someone in a lesser position says no.
We're going to teach you. We'll show you.
Yeah.
Yep. You know, and you don't tell us no.
You don't tell us no. And then they'll try to like, and then some people do the route. They're not going to hurt you, but they're not going to do anything to help you either. So they'll just be like, all right, well, you don't want to do what I'm asking you. So, okay, good luck.
What kind of things push the boundaries too much for you? Like, what are things that you've said no about? Is it specific roles that you're just not comfortable going somewhere?
Yeah, it'll be a role, or it might be just the material or something. You know, and I think everybody is different. You know, everybody's different on what they
are willing to do.
Yeah. But I mean, it could be, you know, stuff like that, you know. But
it's everyone out here. So the egos are so big. Everyone's so sensitive that, yeah, you have to be careful. But I also think you have to police it, you know, when you need to. But, hey, that's not fair.
Right.
Actually what happened was I had another project lined up when you wanted me to do that.
Right.
That's all it was.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. I was under contract. But I'm a big believer in that, too. It's just not allowing that to get out there because it's not fair.
Yeah.
You know, and I see that a lot in Hollywood, too. I mean, I love what we do. I mean, believe it or not. But I do believe it's The Sopranos. It is the life we chose.
Yeah, it's true. I even had to remind myself of that. Just being on set, I didn't know the workload was going to be so intense. Like, I was shooting 13 to 15 hours Monday through Friday for 6 months. And on the weekends, I was memorizing. So at least the crew and the other cast had the weekends off. I'm memorizing 60
you're the
pages.
Lead. Yeah, no.
Because I'm the lead.
Okay.
And I'm almost in every scene and I talk all the whole show.
So so for millennials and fucking civilians, I don't care. Everyone needs to sleep. Everyone needs to eat. I don't care. So if you think 15 hours of acting is easy, well, it's a very...
And people do, but they don't know. Yeah.
It's a very big drain.
Right.
It's a lot of pressure. And to be doing it every day... It's
because I even told one of my friends recently, I was like, yeah, man, I had to work 13 to 15 hours. He was like, you complaining about working, about doing a TV show? And I'm like, I'm thinking you work 8 hours a day and you talking about you drained and you stressed. I'm working. But because they just see it as you're acting, they don't understand it.
Maria and I were talking this week as we're trying. It's no secret. We're trying to conceive and. there's concerns now because most of our weekends, we're just laid out. We're so friggin' exhausted.
Yeah.
It's a Sunday. It's just, if you come here, it's like, we're sure up early because we're normal. We're going to hike or whatever. And then it's like going to go turn on the TV and just, we're both out. We're just passed out.
Yeah.
Because you're just so friggin' exhausted from the drain. You know,
how do you balance that? Because you have a wife and you have a daughter?
Yeah, I have a wife and a daughter, a three-year-old. Yeah, I mean, honestly, luckily I have a wife to cook.
You hear that, Ian?
Right.
Luckily.
Yeah, that's right. No. You know, to cook, I mean.
She does her job.
She does her job.
I'm the same with Maria, but that's our job.
And, you know, yeah, I feel like you have to, like, everybody plays their position, you know. My wife plays her position. I play my position. And, you know, because of that, it allowed me to be able to remember. I mean, her watching our daughter, you know, allowed me to memorize these lines, you know. Right. But she knows that's for the benefit of my career and our family because we want Rush Hour to be successful. And even if it's not successful, we want other people to watch Rush Hour, say, yay, that Justin Hires kid is a talent. And let's use him for something else.
And the whole family wins.
And the whole family wins.
Lifestyle's better.
Absolutely.
Daughter gets a better education. Yeah. No. It's great that she gets it. And a lot of partners don't. Guys and girls.
Absolutely.
Don't get it.
Yeah. Very fortunate.
She never gets jealous of the time you're spending at work or any of those things. She's just supportive. And
well, I think any spouse, man or woman, if it's a lot of time. The quick answer is no. Ultimately, she's supportive. However, I think any spouse, if you're spending a lot of time away, they're gonna at times wish you were there, wish you were around more, wish you could go out more, go on more dates, spend more time with the family. So I think that's always back, you know, there in her mindset somewhere. But ultimately, she knows it's for the greater good of our family, and so she's willing to make that sacrifice.
Does she help you run lines ever, like if you're sitting on the weekend?
Yeah, well, I didn't ask her to do that with Rush Hour because she was already doing so much around the house and taking care of our daughter. I didn't want to add an additional thing for her to have to do. However, prior to Rush Hour, yeah, when I, you know, had certain auditions and for TV shows and Empire, I mean, all that stuff, then yeah, she was the one running lines with me.
What do you do for Rush Hour then? Who helps you out with that?
Nobody. I just do it by myself and rehearsing when I get on set, you know.
Oh.
Yeah, and just we have rehearsal.
Do you read lines in front of the mirror? Do you do it?
Yeah, I do all of that. And just kind of know the cue lines, when to come in.
You got to record yourself on the computer of the cue lines and time it out, and then you got to hit play, and it's like you're being both.
Do you
people.
Do that?
That's no.
Yeah, you got to do that. That's the move.
See, these kids, the millennials, they teach us everything. Now you
teaching.
Know.
You're schooling me.
I'm not, but that's what helps me. Like, I'll record it, and then I'll time it out, and then I'll play with myself.
So that's what you should do, Justin.
Yeah, what
because
if
I do that, you should do
that. I'm about
that.
To say, what if the thing about that is you never know what the reader is going to do.
Yeah, that's true.
Justin, summer plans, any movies lined up, stand-up tour?
Stand-up tour. That's what I'm doing right now. I just went to Boston. This is my first time headlining as a stand-up comedian.
Congratulations.
Thank you. So I just went to Baltimore. I actually had a surprisingly really good turnout for the weekend. And so now I'm going to Rochester, New York. I'm going to Phoenix. I'm going to Edmonton. And where else am I going? So that, and we're lining up more dates. So, I mean, that's kind of what.
And JustinHires.com
Justin
is where we find out.
Yeah, JustinHires.com has my show dates, and all my social media is Justin Hires.
It's really exciting. This is going to be really fun to watch this one unfold.
Thank you.
This is going to be a lot of fun.
I appreciate y'all. I mean, this is honestly, easily, the most informative, probably, I mean, best questions. I mean,
hopefully a little fun.
No
maybe.
Fun. No, it was fun.
We usually have more fun here. I don't know. Mondays are boring. Thursday, if you want to come, we have drinks. It gets really
stupid. We'll get you back on a Thursday. We get good and drunk, and it's fun.
Oh, hilarious. Well, count me in. I mean, I'm down for it. I think what y'all are doing is phenomenal. So that's what I'm doing right now for the summer.
So, very exciting.
Let me just jump in from the booth, by the way. Rush Hour, Thursdays, 10 p.m., 9 central, unless I'm mistaken.
Yeah, absolutely. Yep.
Just want to make sure we get that out there.
And episodes are available for free on CBS.com. And they had the CBS app also. But I think our episodes are still free on CBS.com right now.
Thank you, Uncle Les.
Yeah. Thank you.
So, you know, and yeah, producing for you too, my friend. We need to talk.
Yeah, absolutely.
We'll be talking off air. Yeah, okay. There's stuff that you have to. We have some things we're gonna do. We have some things.
When Keven gets into your life, the life starts to change.
The life starts to change.
In a good way. Mostly. Yeah, in a positive way.
I think, what is it? Is it a chinch bug that comes into the grass and kills?
What's a chinch bug?
It kills a lot of the critters to keep the grass healthy, but then if it's too much, it can kill the grass too. She just needs just enough.
Just enough of you.
Just enough. poor Maria has too much meat. That's why she wants to hang herself or me. But anyway, so, yeah.
What the fuck's a chinch bug?
I think it's a chinch bug.
I never even heard of that.
Hey, man. He's a teacher.
Yeah, well, I'm just old. That's all.
You look great. I don't know how old you are, but I mean, you look good.
Quarter a century in this business. By the way, your wife will look good, too, when you guys are out working.
I know, exactly.
You're Maria. That's why everyone asks, like, how do you look so good? I'm like, Maria, I'm not out there fighting anymore. When I was out there having to throw punches, forget it.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Very exciting. So is it at Justin Hires?
At Justin Hires. Like tires, but with an H, Hires. So
Keven loves
Hires.
That. We like it when people keep it
nice
simple.
And clean, nice and simple, clean. Easy.
Yep.
You are coming back here, and we're going to be seeing a lot more of you.
Holla
I just
me.
Know in the future. Rox, would you agree?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, because she's pretty brutal.
Well, yeah, you know, I ask the questions that it's like a little cringeworthy sometimes. Ian says when he watches at home, when I ask things, he's like, ooh, God.
But what do you think so about tough. His career?
But yeah, I definitely think. I absolutely think. Well, I've been watching the show, and I think you're fucking hysterical.
Oh, thank you.
And
thank
I think
you.
The show's really fun, but I think you shine on it.
Thank you.
Yeah. Ian Kaiser, thoughts? Closing thoughts for Justin Hires, or just maybe just keep your mouth shut?
It's a guarantee. And just the positive. Anyone right. who walks in with a positive attitude like that, we see soar. Like, it's awesome.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I appreciate
it. And now he's got underpower, so.
Yeah. Yes. The world just runs better on underpower. Okay. See you guys. It's at Roxy Stryer.
Yep.
Forget
at
Ian.
Ian Films. No, I got a new.
At
I'm gonna,
Ian Films.
On Instagram. Yeah,
better.
I'm going to do a
okay.
new thing.
At
yeah.
Ian
much,
Films.
Much better, yeah.
It's at Gilkerson Radio, at Lauren LaGrasso. It's at Blatcast.
Yeah, and let me jump in and say that Wednesday night, this Wednesday, 8 p.m. Pacific, we'll be doing a live streaming Blatcast from the studios of AfterBuzz. People will be able to watch us. And this week, you don't even know this, we're debuting Mets 360. I'll be interviewing Jim Brewer, who's a huge Mets fan.
Nice.
Spending a whole hour with him. Yeah.
For all you New York Mets fans, the great Christian Blatt.
I thought he was going to say, you don't even know this, Roxy's coming in. But Roxy, you know, he decided not to say that.
I
started
actually,
waving and shit too, like an asshole.
That's true. Roxy will make a cameo appearance. However long she wants to, she'll be on the live Blattcast on Wednesday.
Very, very nice. Welcome to the AfterBuzz family, Christian Blatt. You guys, info at Tomorrow Show, at the Tomorrow Show. We love all your questions, your comments. And we'll be drinking on Thursday. We'll hopefully have even more fun. But until then, just try to make it a better tomorrow.
Hey, I like that.
Thanks for tuning in to The Tomorrow Show with Keven Undergaro. For guest bookings, questions, or comments, you can email us at info@thetomorrowshow.com. Be sure to follow us on social media and tell a friend about the show. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, your voice of tomorrow, wishing you a better one.